Good morning. Welcome to Bible Christian Church. My name is Pastor Brian. I'm the lead pastor here at Bible Christian, and I just want to say a special welcome to you today. We're so happy that you chose to join us this morning for our special worship service online. I trust that you had a great Christmas day yesterday with your family, and we have some exciting things planned for this morning. If it's your first time joining us online today, you'll notice there's a QR code on the screen in front of you. If you take a moment and scan that QR code, it'll link you to a digital connect card where you can fill in a few pieces of information briefly, and we can get you more information about what all is going on here at Bible Christian Church and the various ministries going on here. If you're one of our regulars and you'd like to continue worshiping this morning by way of giving, you can do so through that QR code, through our website, and through our BCC app as well. And speaking of giving, if you'd like to participate in any special year-end giving, you can do so online in all the ways that I just mentioned, or if you'd like to drop off a physical check or physical amount by our church office, you can do so, and it'll actually count for this calendar year so long as it's dated before the last day of December 2021. So with all that being said, again, we're so happy that you chose to join us. In just a moment, our worship leader, Zach, is going to be leading us in a couple of worship songs, and we hope you'll take this time to worship and enjoy this special service with your family.
Hey, good morning, church. It's so good to be gathered together across our city. We're just going to sing a couple songs this morning. Let's sing this together. Go Tell It on the Mountain.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching, or silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens, there shone a holy night. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. These shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that held the Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born. And God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morning. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Oh, go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. You are here. You're moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, you're moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, you're working in this place. I worship you, God. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are here, you're touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, you're healing every heart. I worship you, God. I worship you. You are here, you're turning lights around. I worship you, God. I worship you. You are here, you're mending every heart. I worship you. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 Oh. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. Never stop working, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
So, Father God, we praise you this morning. God, we just thank you for just allowing us to worship together, even though we're apart. God, I just pray that as Pastor Brian prepares to bring the word, we just tune in and lean into what you have to say to us and just speak through him. And God, again, we just thank you for this season, and we thank you for just focusing us in on the true meaning of all this. It's in your name we pray.
Let me begin with a question this morning. Do you remember what you received for Christmas last year? Not yesterday Christmas, last year's Christmas. Let's go back one more year past that. Do you remember what you got for Christmas the year before that? If you have a really good memory, maybe possibly you remember what you received for Christmas 2 years ago, but probably not, right? Most Christmas gifts are quickly forgotten. In fact, there was actually a study back in 2018 that found most people actually forget most of the gifts they receive for Christmas. The study found that 1 out of 6 gifts will actually never be touched again after January the 1st. It's incredible, isn't it? The other thing it found is it revealed that men are most likely to purchase the most forgettable gifts. Imagine that, ladies. And siblings were found to give the worst gifts. You see, most gifts that come from around the tree are broken or lost, or they become next year's yard sale fodder within a couple of months. They don't have a very long lifespan, and they're quickly forgotten. I remember as a kid wanting a very special gift one Christmas. I had asked for a Fisher-Price 3-in-1 pool table, ping pong table, and hockey table. It was the most incredible thing ever. I had pulled out the toy wish list catalog, and I'd looked through it, and I'd circled it, and I'd asked my parents for it, and it's what I thought was going to bring me all the joy in the world. I thought I would play with it every single day. It was going to bring me all kinds of joy and fulfillment up until I was like 40, okay? Well, Christmas morning, I woke up, and my parents were kind enough to purchase that gift for me, and they had it set up in what was our playroom at the time. And I remember Christmas morning opening the door and walking in, and it was incredible. I looked at the pool table and I could hear angels begin to sing in the background, and there was a bright glow coming from around my new pool table. It was a very strange experience, I'll admit, all right? But here's the deal. I played with that pool table Christmas Day and maybe a day or two after that, and then past that, maybe 10 days in total, and then I was bored with it. I quickly lost interest in that gift that I wanted so badly. It quickly became a thing that just sat in the corner and collected dust, and it stopped bringing me enjoyment. I'm sure you've probably had an experience like that too, because material gifts don't keep on giving forever. But here's the deal today. We've just come through Christmas, and the amazing gift we celebrate at Christmas is Jesus Christ in a new relationship that we can find in Him by faith. And that new relationship is the only gift that keeps on giving. Well, at least it's meant to. You see, the love of God was shown to us in a special way at Christmas through Jesus. And that same love is meant to branch out into the world around us through us. You know, John the disciple actually had a lot to say about this love that we've been given that we celebrate at Christmas. 1 John 4, verse 9 says this, "This is how God showed His love among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him. You see, what we celebrate at Christmas is right there in that first sentence. God loved us, and His love overflowed into giving. That's what genuine love, true love, really does. It gives of itself to others. And God didn't give us something cheap. Have you ever received a cheap gift that you know required no thought or effort? I'm sure that we all have. Maybe it was a gift that had been re-gifted to you. That kind of gift, though, doesn't come usually from a place of love. And it has very little impact and very little meaning to us. That's not what we see in our God. God loved us, and that love overflowed into Him, giving what was most valuable to Him, His only Son, Jesus. What a precious gift, and what a sacrifice He made to give that very gift of Jesus. But John continues in verse 10. "This is love," he says, "not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." Verse 11, "Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another." He says, if you're looking for a definition of true love, look no further than the gift of Jesus. And then in verse 11, he said, since God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. Just as Jesus sacrificed Himself for us, we should sacrifice ourselves for others too. You see, the way Jesus gave up His life for others is our example. And I'll tell you, this giving from Jesus, it didn't just start at the cross. Jesus lived a life of love all throughout His earthly ministry. And the guy writing this would have known that. See, John, the guy writing this, saw Jesus live out this love towards those around Him. John was known as one of those in the inner circle of Jesus. Likely, John was Jesus' best friend and watched Jesus firsthand. When little children gathered around Him, Jesus could have shooed them away and said, I don't have time for this. I have more important things to do. But He didn't. He took time for them and He showed love to them. When a woman caught in adultery was thrown at His feet, Jesus could have condemned her. But instead, He showed love to her and told her to go and sin no more. And then even as Jesus hung on the cross and people cursed at Him and spit at Him and mocked Him, He could have rained down judgment upon all of them or at least defended Himself, but He didn't. He cried out, "Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing." See, John watched Jesus live this life of self-sacrifice, this life of love, of giving His life away to those around Him out of love for them. And John says that same Jesus, He's our pattern for how God's love is to be lived out to others around us. This kind of love is focused on the needs of other people, not our own. This kind of love is an initiating love. It makes the first move. That's what we see in Jesus. But here's what's incredible as He rounds out this section of the chapter. What He says is, we are one of the ways other people experience the love of God. Look at verse 12. John says, no one has ever seen God. What he means is, God is not physically visible here on earth. He's invisible. God is spirit, okay? No one's seen Him physically. But look at what he says. But if we love one another, God lives in us and His love is made complete in us. Think about that with me for a minute. That means that even though God is invisible in this world physically, our love as Christians and the way we treat others makes Him visible to the world. Now, this passage is specifically written to Christians and how they are to treat other Christians or other believers. But here's the thing. The principle given here is also true for how we love those who don't know Jesus yet as well. You might remember when Jesus was confronted by one of the religious lawyers of the day, and they asked him, which is the greatest commandment? Jesus said, here's the greatest commandment. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. And he said, the second is likened to it. He said, love your neighbor as yourself. And he said, all the law hangs on these two commands. See, it was all about loving others and how we treat others, Christians and those who don't know Jesus yet. You see, let's think about this for a minute. See, some of the people God has planted around you will only see God's love when it's displayed through your life and through my life. It's incredible to think about, isn't it? And that's an incredible responsibility too. And what this means is this. God wants to reveal His love to those around us through us. Can we say that together? Let's say that together right there from your couch. Ready? Go. God wants to reveal His love to those around us through us. What a privilege we have as God's children to display His love to the world around us. And listen, for sure, God can show His love. He has the power to show His love to people in other ways too. He can do it through miracles in their life. He can do it through common grace in their life. He can do it through tragedy. He can do it through the Bible if they'll take the time to read it. But what John is saying is one of the primary ways that God communicates His love to people is through us, His children. Our love for others is proof that God, he says, is living in us. And then John says that God's love is made complete in us. And I think that's twofold. I think we experience God's love in its fullest measure when we unselfishly love those around us. But it also means that God's love is not finished working until it is worked both in you and through you. Let's say that part together as well. Ready? Go. God's love is not finished working until it is worked both in you and through you. You see, God's love isn't supposed to just rest on us. It's not supposed to just end with us. It's supposed to continue working through us. Have you ever been in a drive-thru and had the pay-it-forward thing happen to you? Where you pay for the person's meal in the car behind you because the person in front of you paid for yours, and you get there and you hope to goodness that the person behind you in line is not a mom with 10 kids in a conversion van or a van full of hungry college students. That's really your hope and your prayer, if we're honest. But the idea is that you receive that gift from the person in front of you, and then you don't just say, oh, thank you, and you pull off. No, that doesn't look good on you when you do that, if you're that person. Now, the idea is that you receive the gift from the person in front of you and you keep it going and give it to the next guy. And he gives it to the next guy and he gives it to the next guy. And in theory, it should go on forever. See, that's what John is saying here. You see, it's amazing to be God's child, to have received this great gift, this love, and the forgiveness that we've been shown in Jesus. It's so amazing to be adopted into God's family, but receiving God's love is only part of the plan. Yes, you're saved. Yes, you're a Christian if you've received God's love by way of faith. But John says God's love is not finished until it is working through you and given to others through you. See, God's love is made complete in us and through us. God's love shown to us at Christmas, it's a gift that should keep on giving. So here's the question for you today as we close. How will you let God's love branch out from you? In the new year, how will you let God's love branch out from you? God has special ways He wants to use you to extend His love to those around you in the coming year. It's going to cost you. It'll probably require sacrifice, just as God's love required sacrificing His Son. But I'll tell you, it's worth it. Will you allow God to use you in this way to display His love to those around you in the coming year? You know, all the other gifts you received yesterday on Christmas came from around the tree. But the greatest gift we celebrate in this season is Jesus. And Jesus was a gift hung on a tree. Jesus, out of His great love for us, He sacrificed Himself. He suffered and died on a cross so that we could have this new relationship. In this new relationship and that love we've been given on Calvary's tree on that cross is meant to branch out to those around us through us. You see, in that way, Jesus is truly the gift that keeps on giving. And He does so through you, through me. So, as you begin to put away the Christmas decorations and the tree this year, and the Christmas season dies, may the love we've been given through Christmas live on every day of the year through us. And here's what I want you to do right now. In just a moment, I'm going to put some questions on the screen in front of you that you can answer and discuss together with your family. Once you finish discussing, parents, I'd like for you to share with your family a story of a time when God used you specifically to show His love in a special way to someone else around you. And then I want to encourage you as a family to have a time of prayer together, asking God to help you branch out His love in the coming year. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the opportunity to have opened Your Word this morning. We thank You for the year You've brought us through, for Your faithfulness, for Your goodness, and for Your love. Father, we thank You for the love that we've read about today, that You showed us the sacrifice and the love that You showed us in sending the greatest gift ever, Jesus Christ. Help us to branch out that love to everyone around us in the coming year, to look for specific ways and unique ways that we can show the love of Jesus so that He can truly be that gift that keeps on giving through our lives. Father, we ask Your blessings on everyone that calls BCC home, and I pray that You give us a great remainder of the day. We love You. In Jesus' name, amen. May we all allow God's love to branch out from us to those around us in the year to come. I want to thank you all for joining us today for this special online gathering. I hope you have a great day with your family. I hope you have a happy new year. You can press pause right now and talk through the following questions with your family. And we'll see you next Sunday. God bless.
Thank you.